Welcome to Pilgrim's Progress. I'm Ray Greenlee, pastor of the National Prayer Chapel. Thank you for joining today. I pray that this broadcast will help you in your journey as you make your way from this world to the world which is to come. On this broadcast, we read together the book Pilgrim's Progress. It is edited by C.J. Levick, Crossway Publishers, edited by a man in 2009. It is an excellent update for this classic allegory. It was first published in 1678 and has been of immense value in the life of Christians as they have walked this journey on the narrow path. Of course, the author is John Bunyan. He spent 12 years in prison because he refused to stop preaching the gospel. He was not a pastor. He was not a preacher. He was a tinker. That is, he repaired pots and pans. It was a dirty job, a job that didn't pay very much. John Bunyan paid a tremendous price as he served Jesus Christ. He had tragedy in his life on several occasions. I hope you know that this journey from this world to the world which is to come is a journey that has much joy, much love, much peace, but also much tribulation, much persecution. You're welcome to go to our webpage, nationalprayerchapel.com. We're streaming live there. Some of you have been asking, how could we get copies of these broadcasts? The answer is you can go to nationalprayerchapel.com and you can download any of the videos that you would like. They are public YouTube videos, and you can download them the same as you do any other YouTube video. And you're welcome to do that at no cost, at no charge. I also welcome you to come and visit the National Prayer Chapel. If you are serious about this journey and you would like to fellowship or visit with some people who are also very serious about this journey, then you're welcome to come and visit the National Prayer Chapel. We have our services in Woodbridge, Virginia at All Saints Anglican Church. It's on Gideon Drive. We're right off Route 95. And you're welcome to come. If you go to nationalprayerchapel.com, you can get the directions there. Or you're welcome to call me. I'll give you that phone number, 703-672-1203. That number again, 703-672-1203. If I don't answer that cell, please leave a message and I will call you back. Now, if you'd like to join in studio today, you're welcome. The telephone number is 877-534-0780. That number again, 877-534-0780. Today I'm going to begin sharing with you the story of Mr. Temporary. It's found on page 207 in the chapter entitled Stubborn Ignorance for those of you who are following. Hopeful is asked the question, do you know a man named Temporary who lived in your parts about 10 years ago? He was a devotedly religious man back then. Hopeful replied, oh yes, I did know him. He lived in the town of Graceless, about 2 miles away from the town of Honesty. He lived next to Mr. Turnback. Right, Christian said. Those two lived under the same roof. Well, that man was at one time much awakened to the seriousness of his own sin and of the wages that were due them. Well, I think you're right, Hopeful confirmed, for my house was only 3 miles from him. He would often come to visit me when in distress and full of tears. Truly, I pitied the man and was not altogether without hope for him. But then again, not everyone who cries, Lord, Lord. Christian cut him off and said, He told me once that he was resolved to go on pilgrimage as we are now. But all of a sudden, he grew acquainted with Mr. Save Self, and then he became a stranger to me. And I just wonder, today, have you made the decision to make the journey from this world to the world which is to come? And what progress are you making in that journey? I'm going to share with you today reasons for backsliding as given by John Bunyan. And a part of this question of backsliding is about public and private duties. Now let me define just for a moment. We usually think of duties as something that we have to do and we're not very happy about it. But frankly, that's really not true. One of my duties is to prepare food. If I didn't prepare food, I would starve to death. So it's not hard for me to prepare food. I prepare food with joy because I'm looking forward to sitting down and eating that wonderful food. Or another of my jobs is to take care of my wash. If I got up in the morning and went to my dresser and opened the drawers and looked for clean clothes, and there were no clean clothing, I would be in crisis. That would not be enjoyable. But because I've done the wash, and I've dried and folded my clothing and put it away, I've done my duty to prepare, and then I can enjoy wearing the clothing. Duties are those things that most of the time are, frankly, enjoyable. There are some duties that I find onerous. I'm not eager, I put them off. But most duties I find enjoyable because not only are they enjoyable to do, but the result is very enjoyable. We're going to talk about some of these private and public duties that a Christian has, and that when they're not performed, backsliding begins. So let's begin John Bunyan's description of the reasons that Mr. Temporary and others begin to backslide. Well, there are four reasons. The first would be that though the conscience of such men are awakened, their minds are not changed. Thus, when the power of guilt fades away, those things that provoked them to be religious stop, and they naturally turn to their own course again. It's like the sick dog who vomits all that he's eaten and casts it all out, not because he has a mind to do so, but only because his stomach is upset. When the upset stomach goes away, the dog returns to his vomit and licks it up again. And so it is true, as it is written, the dog turned to his own vomit again. I conclude that if they long for heaven only by virtue of their fear of the torments of hell, then as their senses of hell and the fear of damnation chill and cool, so do their desires for heaven and salvation cool also. So then it comes to pass that when their guilt and fear are gone, their desire for heaven and happiness die, and they return to their former ways again. This aspect of backsliding is not much in vogue today because most people have never experienced a fear of damnation. There might be a twinge of guilt occasionally, but in our culture, we've found ways to put away that guilt, to numb it down. We can use the television or the sports or some recreation or some music or conversation, or we have many different ways in our culture of numbing our hearts and our minds so that whatever the pain is, it can quickly be dissipated. The fact is, we really do need to be awakened. And we do need to see our condition before God. And we do need to hear that honest word from the Holy Spirit regarding our real condition before God. This is frightening to me because when I look at the New Testament church, I look at how they lived and what happened. I look at their fervor in following after Jesus, their dedication. I find myself falling far short of that. I find that in my life, I also have backslidden from the New Testament church. See, I can't use as my standard what is happening in the men and women around me. I have to look at it in a historical context. When I read about John Wesley's life, I'm always deeply convicted. Here was a man who sacrificed everything, his whole life, living righteous before God, having new vistas opened before him constantly. And as he would begin to preach the gospel, men and women would fall under deep conviction of sin, and they would flee to Jesus for release and for deliverance. As he would stand preaching the gospel, men and women would suddenly have the Holy Spirit fall upon them, and not only would they be convicted of their sin, but their sickness would be healed, their bodies would be healed. And often in his meetings, there would be shouts of victory, shouts of triumph, as their diseases were taken by Jesus, by his stripes, were healed. I don't experience that yet at the National Prayer Chapel. I will one day. I'm standing by faith. I'm standing by faith that as I proclaim the gospel on this broadcast, that wonderful things will begin to happen in your life as you closely examine your life in the light of Scripture, not in light of the modern-day Christian or the modern-day church. That's one of the reasons I'm sharing together with you this book, The Pilgrim's Progress. It's one of the old landmarks, if you would, in the walk with Jesus. The writings of Jonathan Edwards, the writings of other great Puritans, the writings of Charles Finney. Now, I don't agree always with all of their theology. This dear man by the name of Fox, what an awesome, wonderful life of service he lived for Jesus Christ. I have to look at my life in light of the historical context of not only the New Testament, but also of those great men of God who have come in the centuries past, who have been so endowed by the Holy Spirit, so graced with his presence, that everywhere they went, conviction of sin followed them. Let's look at the second reason for backsliding. This is page 208. A second reason for backsliding is that they have slavish fears that control them. I'm talking about the fears that they have of men. For the fear of man brings a snare. So then they seem so long to earnestly desire heaven while the flames of hell are about their ears. Yet when the terror is over, they have second thoughts. They begin to think that it's good to be wise in the worldly sense and not run the hazard of losing it all, or at the very least, of bringing themselves into avoidable and unnecessary trouble. Because of their fear of what man might do to an honest pilgrim, they fall in with the world again. Now, the next reason also brings a very similar issue. The next reason for backsliding is the shame that attends true religion, which makes it a stumbling block to them. They are proud and haughty and consider true religion to be low and contemptible when they have lost their sense of hell and wrath to come. They return to their former course. You recognize that these comments that he's making about backsliding are all in the context of the gospel being honestly proclaimed and men and women being confronted with their true condition before God, being confronted with the actual sin of their heart and of their life. When that occurs, and men in fear begin to search after God, there has to be a bridge then built where they give themselves up to the Lord, where they sacrifice their lives to Jesus, where they no longer hold anything back, but they're utterly and completely given over to follow after Jesus Christ. In the culture of our church today, this happens very seldom. Most often today, a person is invited to receive Jesus as their Lord and Savior. The minor note is, and repent from your sin and receive Jesus. The emphasis is not on, will Jesus receive you? The emphasis is on, will you receive him? And to be very frank with you, that's a deception. A person is not prepared to answer the question, will you receive Jesus, until they have fully understood their true condition before God. They have to understand the very tenuous place in which they live. They have to understand the threat to their life, the very real probability that they are going to be cast into utter darkness. They're going to be cut off from the land of the living. They're going to no longer be able to enjoy the pleasures of this life. They're going to be cast into hell. Until a person is aware of these facts, and until these facts have settled deep into the soul, and they recognize that the major question of their existence is, will God accept me? Will God bring me into the kingdom of his son, Jesus? Until that question is honestly faced, it is not worthwhile to even ask the question, will you receive Jesus? How can a person receive Jesus and add him to an already full life? It's like the man who went to a master and said, "Will you teach me the way of life?" And the master said, "Come, let's have some tea." And so he handed the young man a mug, and he began to pour the hot tea into the mug for him. And when the mug was full, he continued pouring. And the tea began to spill all over the floor. And the young man pulled the mug back and he said, "No, no, there's no more room." And the master said, "Just as your life is full, there is no room for me to teach you the way of life. First go and empty your mug and then come back. And then you could receive the way of life." The old master was right. If your life is full, how can you receive one more thing? If your life is full of all of the activities and responsibilities of life, if your life is full of family and children and activities and social events and shopping and entertainment, if your life is completely full, how can you receive Jesus into your life as one more wonderful thing that you can have, one more gift that you could have? I went and visited in a family's home recently, and I was astonished because in the guest bedroom, there were piles of Christmas gifts unopened. And I asked the lady of the house, "What are all of these gifts, these wrapped gifts I see in the guest room?" And she said, "Oh, those are gifts we've not yet had time to open. We'll try to get around to it sometime." They receive so much. They have so much that to open one more gift is of no interest to them. There isn't anything they need or want. Their life is completely full. They are overflowing with stuff, with things. That's how it is for many of you as you come to Jesus. And he'll keep pouring into your cup as it overflows, because you have no room to receive. Room to receive only comes as someone becomes honest with us and begins to speak the truth, even though an unpleasant truth, about the real condition of our heart. Now, if we're really honest, and I pray you are today, you will have to admit with me that there are probably areas of your life that are a disaster. There are probably areas of your life that need to be transformed by the blood of Jesus. But if you don't take time to listen to the Holy Spirit, you'll continue to walk with the fullness of this world, and you will not ever come into that place of receiving the gifts of God. You can't receive. There's no room. What progress are you making toward heaven? Are you loaded down today with a busy agenda? Are you loaded down with a myriad of responsibilities that of utmost importance, so that you have no time for the reading of the word and no time for prayer, no time for guarding your heart against lust, no time for considering your real condition before God? What is the condition of your heart? If you were to become embarrassingly honest, how would you answer that question? Then we come to the fourth and the last explanation of this falling back, backsliding. Lastly, the guilt and terror that comes to mind as they consider their own miserable condition is something that grieves them, but it does not cause them to fly to Christ for safety. No, instead it causes them to try to avoid all such terrible thoughts. When their awakening to the terrors and wrath of God fade away, then they choose ways that will harden them in any such awakening in the future. I have watched over and over the cause of backsliding in most of us is that we forget conveniently about the wrath of God against all sinners. And we focus instead on God is my friend. God is my companion. Jesus loves me. I'm going to heaven. Even though what I'm saying does not line up with the actual reality of my life. There's a great difference between what a person knows and what a person does. And the struggle of my life has been to bring into harmony what I know intellectually with what my inner life is and with what the reality of my standing is before God. That's why I have such an emphasis in this ministry upon allowing the blood of Jesus to break all of the bondages of our hearts. Now, many have been taught that our standing before God is based on what Jesus Christ has done plus nothing. Many have been taught that it's by grace, that salvation is a free gift. And all of this is true. But it requires a crucifixion. It requires going through Gethsemane, of allowing that crushing stone to fall upon us, to allow ourselves to fall on the rock and be broken. A person who refuses to fall upon the rock and be broken is, quite frankly, a person who can never be saved. They can be extremely religious. They can call themselves a Christian. But they will not have victory over their sin. And they'll live continually going from defeat to defeat, repenting and repenting and repenting with never having victory in that area of their life. Or frankly, many areas, most areas of their life. It is possible with the human flesh and the human spirit to force ourselves to conform to an outward righteousness. But it's impossible to clean the spring of the heart through human effort. You can repress it, and for a time you won't see it springing up, and then it will burst forth in another area. One dear man cried out to God to deliver him from cigarettes, only to have pornography burst forth in his life. Why? Because the root of his heart was that he still refused to fall on that rock and be broken. He had not yet been crucified with Christ, so he was still alive. Let's come back now, Christian said, you have summed it up well. At the bottom of it all is the simple truth that these men never changed their will or their mind. That is, they never truly repent. They are like the criminal who stands before the judge, quaking and trembling. He seems to genuinely repent, but at the bottom of it all is a fear of prison, not any real remorse for his crimes. If he is set free, he will return to his criminal activity. If his mind had truly been changed, he would stop being a criminal. Now then, I've shown you the reasons for backsliding. Now let's talk about the manner in which they backslide. Okay, Christian answered. First, the backsliders resist all thoughts of God and death and the judgment to come. Thus, to continue their resistance, they begin to, by degrees, cast off private duties, such as closet prayer, curbing their lusts, watching their souls, grieving over their sin, and the like. They also begin to shun the company of lively and warm Christians. So Bunyan is saying that when we begin to cast off the private duties of the soul, the reading of Scripture, the private prayer, the curbing, the rejecting of lust, when we stop watching our soul, not having a care for what happens, when we give up grieving over sin, if not sin in ourselves, then sin in a brother or sister. And we begin to cut ourselves off from fellowshipping with those Christians who would hold us accountable, but begin to walk in our own way. He's saying this brings about a turning from the Lord. This brings about a deadening of the soul. It begins to lead us into a place of backsliding. After this mostly private resistance, they then grow cold to their public duties, such as hearing God's word preached, reading the Bible, assembling together with other Christians. And I would add to that, they stop giving the Lord their tithes and their offerings. They begin to say, I don't need to give this, the church doesn't need it. They begin to give it in other places. My son, my daughter needs financial help, I believe I'll give it to them. One man I watched as he struggled with his sin, and he gave his tithe, his offering, to his family. He struggled with sin. But at the bottom of it, he still had not died. He wanted his time to belong to himself. He wanted his money to belong to himself. He wanted his friends and associates to belong to himself. He was unwilling to come into that relationship with Jesus Christ where all on the altar was laid. And so in your life, if you find these aspects of private and public duty, you find that you're no longer reading the Scriptures or assembling with the believers. You're no longer giving the tithes and the offerings. You're pulling back when you go to church, you begin to be critical, judgmental. Suddenly, you're beginning to backslide. They start to abandon the assembly of believers, finding fault with other Christians, often naming them hypocrites, in order to provide an excuse for their leaving. One time, at the National Prayer Chapel, a couple began to be very upset with the teaching of righteousness. And so this man began to accuse me of lying. I had not lied. I'd been brutally honest. But his accusation was that I had lied to him. And based on that accusation, they were free to leave. This is a condition of backsliding. Often we have to demonize to justify our own behavior. We have to come up with every reason why this pastor, who at one point was giving us the word of life, and we loved him and we respected him, and there wasn't anything we wouldn't do for him or her. Suddenly, as backsliding begins to set in and secret sins begin to grow in the heart, and resentments then begin to rise up, and this person who was once held in highest esteem, although they do nothing different, suddenly becomes an object of gossip and scorn to justify leaving the fellowship. I've watched this in many churches. I've talked with many pastors about this demonizing of the leadership to break the unity of fellowship. And off they go. And the other interesting thing that I've noted is when this happens in a church, usually the backsliders then begin to get together and talk together and encourage one another in their backsliding. They begin to have fellowship with one another. Suddenly, when they were not friends before, they become best of friends, best buddies, because now they have a common enemy. This is all a part of the backsliding. Having abandoned the fellowship of the saints, they then begin to draw close to and associate themselves with others of like mind, fleshly, loose, greedy, lewd, and unruly men. This new company tempts them to give way to fleshly and lewd practices, at first in secret. They're glad if they can find any fault or sin in those they once considered honest, using them as an excuse and an example to justify their own sins. And after this season of private sin, they begin to play with certain sins openly. Finally, then, being hardened, they show themselves for what they are. Then they are launched again into the gulf of misery, and unless a miracle of grace prevents it, they perish forever in their own deceit. Most backsliders have been deceived by the enemy of men's souls. But who can throw a stone? As I said at the beginning of this broadcast, I recognize that I have not ever lived at the level of devotion, at the level of complete submission that the apostles lived, that many in the New Testament church lived. This is a point of grief for my soul. I've been crying out to the Lord about it and saying, Lord, there has to be a change in my heart. There has to be a change in me. There has to be a renewal of that fire of Pentecost. How do we even begin to speak about this? Last night, in my eagerness to find this New Testament Pentecost presence and power, I attended a church service, not at the National Prayer Chapel. It was a service billed as a Holy Spirit conference. And so I went with great expectation to this conference. And as the pastor, the guest pastor, began to speak, he began to lay out in very clear terms the way faith operates and the need for the Holy Spirit to interface with the will of the Father. And all of that is true. But then he began to veer off course. He began saying things like, God wants to heal every sick person. That if a person is sick and dying, God wants to heal them. It is the will of God to heal every person. And of course, you can go to the scriptures, to Isaiah 53, by his stripes we are healed. Go to many other wonderful scriptures of promise. But in all of those, it is if we ask God in accordance with his will, and I've discovered it's a very dangerous thing to begin to tell God what his will is in a given situation. In my own experience, I have discovered that there are times when the Lord chooses to take a person home, that it's not his divine will to heal that person, or that it's not his will to raise them up out of a wheelchair. It's his will that they be in that wheelchair as a testimony and as a witness that in their suffering, the grace of Christ is enough. The thorn in the Apostle Paul's flesh, probably a physical thorn. We don't know. The scriptures don't tell us. But what the scriptures do tell us is that the Lord said, no, my grace is sufficient for you. In other words, I'm not going to take care of this. I want you to have this thorn in your flesh. No doubt helping to keep Paul humble before the Almighty God. I've discovered it's quite dangerous to begin to assume that I know the will of God in a given situation. I know the general will of God. I know the general will of God as expressed in Scripture is to heal every sick person. But I know in the specific will of God, it is not always his will to heal every person. And I have been with people as they were dying who had been shunned by their church and condemned by their pastor, because they were in hospice and they were dying. And from the pulpit they have been condemned because they did not have enough faith to believe. And so with the faith to believe and they are still dying, they're shunned and condemned by their church. This man began to preach along these lines that God will heal every person, and if you are not healed, it's because you're not believing in the right way, and you have to learn all of these intricate ways of God. You have to learn all of the secrets of faith. And then when you know all of these things, you can touch God for any amount of money you need, or you can touch God for anything you want, and God will grant it to you. That it's God's will to prosper you and bless you. So I sat listening to this man as he jumped the tracks. I began to cry out to the Lord and say, Lord, when these kinds of things are taught, how shall we live? There were people in that congregation who earnestly desired Jesus, who had a great hunger in their heart for Jesus Christ. And so they were being told wonderful things. You can have it all. God loves you. If you'll just exercise your faith, you can reach out and take off of God's table all of the wonderful gifts He has for you. What I began to recognize is that there was no word of rebuke for sin. There was no unveiling of the condition of our hearts before God. It was simply, God loves you. God wants to give you all the gifts of heaven. And you can receive them if you just learn from me the right methodology to receive these things. It was truth and error mixed together. And my heart began to grieve because as I read the scriptures, I'm learning that the only way to move into this Pentecost place is the way John Wesley did, the way other great men of God did, and that is through honest repentance. I'd like to know what God is doing in your heart. 877-534-0780. That number again, 877-534-0780. Hi, Michelle. Welcome. What would you like to share?
Hi, Pastor. I'd like to share victory that I got. I know I had called in last week, and I had shared how Jesus convicted me of my way of being tight and just being very straight and not walking in mercy. And I had shared how someone had hurt me, and I had wished them happy birthday, and they had asked for for a gift, and I said, well, in my heart I can't do this. And the Lord convicted me by saying, no, Michelle, be merciful, show love, and walk in righteousness as I've commanded you. And I did that, and the person got the gift. They called me, and they said, thank you. But then they called yesterday, and they said to me, Michelle, I need to apologize for something that I did. And I listened, and I said, what? And they said, forgive me, because I think I exploited you when I asked you for that gift. And I smiled in my heart, and I said, you're forgiven, and thank you, for being honest with me. Then I said, well, let me tell you what happened when you asked for that gift that day, and I shared how the Lord had convicted my heart. And it's so real, this walk is so real, and I just felt so happy, because I wanted to say, look at this person, they're grabbing, they're trying to grab and get what they want. And I was going to say, no, I can't, but I humbled myself, and I showed love. And in doing that, it broke that person's heart. I know Jesus is dealing with them, and I didn't have to say anything. I didn't have to withhold. I just blessed them. And so through me humbling myself and repenting of my sin, the Lord is dealing with that person and their heart and their sin. And that's my victory today.
And what a victory.
Yes.
What a victory. The Lord was able to break your heart.
Yeah.
And then He was able to break their heart.
Yes. Yes.
And I know that this is the way of the cross. It's exposing and uncovering those things in our own heart that block the Holy Spirit from having free access.
Yes.
And when He speaks to us and He unveils that, there is a trembling that comes into our soul. Thank you, Michelle.
Okay.
Okay. I know that what Michelle is saying is right, that God wants to unveil these things in our hearts. And if we, well, let me read this to you. I'm reading from Ephesians, the fourth chapter, verse 11. It was he who gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, some to be pastors and teachers, to prepare God's people for works of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of men in their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will all in all things grow up into him who is head, that is Christ. From him the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love, as each does its work. You know, what my heart wants is not to be in any way tossed this way and that way by the teaching of cunning and skillful and deceiving men. I want to grow up into the fullness of Jesus, and I'm praying for that conviction. Lord, I just lift up my heart now, and I pray for conviction in all of our hearts, that you would uncover the depths of our soul, that you in your great love and mercy would not let us be deceived in our earnestness to find you, but that our hearts would be open for the work of the Holy Spirit to convict us of our sin and to unveil where we are undone. And Lord, I pray that we will be awakened by your Spirit, that we would not walk backslidden before you, O God, but in your mercy, save us for your name's sake. Amen. God bless you. I'll talk with you tomorrow.
Before the presence of his glory with great joy, with great joy. Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy. Jesus.